So first, thank you so much for inviting me. It's really an honor to speak to this very young crop of our most promising scholars that are in this elite group of the Max Weber Fellows. So my talk today will provide a global overview of migrant domestic workers, but as Anna said, I think one of my strongest points as a scholar is I always stick very close to my data. So towards the end, I will draw from my current project, which is on migrant domestic workers in the United Arab Emirates and Singapore. So domestic work, according to the UN, we're going to start by defining it. So according to the International Labor Organization, refers to, quote, work performed in or for a household or households, unquote. So domestic workers would include house cleaners, elderly caregivers, and nannies. So in 2011, the International Labor Organization successfully passed Convention 189, otherwise known as the Convention on Decent Work for Domestic Workers. Suggesting the global recognition of domestic work, this convention sought to establish a standard of employment for domestic workers. Indeed, this convention led to the enactment of legal reforms for the greater protection of domestic workers in many countries, including, for instance, Singapore and Lebanon, both of which have since instituted a mandatory weekly day off. Further suggesting the recognition of domestic work is the existence of official recruitment programs for migrant domestic workers in various countries where domestic workers can obtain legal residency through the sponsorship of their employer. So these destinations are varied and include Canada, Italy, Denmark, Israel, Lebanon, Gulf Cooperative Council countries such as Saudi Arabia and the United Arab Emirates, and various destinations in Asia, including Singapore, Taiwan, Malaysia, and Hong Kong. But despite these positive signs, including the ratification of the ILO Convention 189, there are still limits to the full recognition of domestic work. So while numerous countries recognize the dependence of its citizenry on paid domestic work and accordingly designate a labor visa to migrant domestic workers, many still do not fully recognize migrant domestic work. So across the globe, these workers are not given complete rights as workers, as they are legally constructed as unfree workers whose regularization is contingent not only on their live-in employment, but also their continuous employment with a sponsor. So they are what we could call tied workers or bound laborers, as they are without employer flexibility, meaning they have limited rights to quit their employment and search for a new employer. So there are basically three central conditions to being a bound laborer. And so one is that someone has to work solely for their employer. Second, in the case of domestic work, they have to be a live-in employer. And the third is that they cannot freely change their employers. So in this talk, I want to focus on the experiences and the constitution of these workers as bound workers. And I want to examine their legal status, more specifically, like I said, their constitution as unfree workers, and address the question of how this unfreedom then shapes their labor conditions. So as I will establish, most countries with a proactive recruitment program for migrant domestic workers have instituted policies and regulations that restrict their ability to fully participate in the labor market. So legally, we can say domestic workers are never incorporated as independent workers when they migrate from one country to another, but instead they're constituted as household dependents. So it's this absence of freedom for migrant domestic workers that I want to examine in this talk and use as a springboard to analyze the politics of gender, citizenship, and migration for migrant workers in the 21st century. So of the estimated 86 million migrant workers worldwide, most are actually unskilled, and women make up approximately 49% of this international migrant labor force. And the majority of unskilled female migrant workers, they say it's about 83% of unskilled female migrant workers, are domestic workers. So migrant domestic workers originate from a wide range of source countries that include Ethiopia and Kenya in Africa, Estonia, Poland, and among others, Ukraine and Eastern Europe, Nepal, Myanmar, Sri Lanka, India, the Philippines, and Indonesia and Asia. And in Latin America, common source countries include Brazil, El Salvador, Mexico, Nicaragua, and among others, Peru. So across the globe, the largest number of migrant domestic workers are of Indonesian origin, followed by Filipinos. And together, these two nationalities make up the majority of Asian women labor migrants. So according to the Philippine government, there's approximately 10 million Filipinos currently residing abroad, and about 41% of them, so 4.1 million, are what you can say are temporary labor migrant workers. So for Indonesian, the government cite 8 million workers residing abroad, and about 45% of them are temporary migrant workers. And so for both countries, those deployed as domestic workers actually constitute the biggest number of all of their labor migrants globally. So for example, from the Philippines, there was about 631,000 domestic workers who left the country between 2009 and 2013. So in comparison, between 2011 and 2013, there were about 900,000 migrant domestic workers that left Indonesia to pursue work abroad. And so then if you compare, well, what's this next biggest group during that time period? So in the Philippines, the second largest group of migrant workers were nurses, and there was about 75,000 of them. So you can see the stark difference between 600,000 domestic workers to 75,000 nurses. And the contrast is more stark for Indonesia, where the next biggest group after the 900,000 domestic workers are plantation workers, and they constituted about 50,000 workers. Most Filipino and Indonesian migrant workers are actually concentrated in Asia and the Middle East, but while they're concentrated in that region of the world, I do want to acknowledge that the global flow of domestic workers is pretty expansive, and so as we know, they go east to west, as we see with Eastern Europeans coming here, but we should note that Eastern Europeans also constitute a large number of migrant domestic workers in Israel. There's a lot of south to north migration, as we see with Latin Americans going to the US, but we also see Filipinos going to Europe and Canada. But what we should really emphasize is that the vast majority of migrant domestic workers are actually interregional migrants. And so you see that with east to west migrants here in Europe. But interregionally, most of them are going south to south. So for example, Peruvians are going to Chile, Filipinos are going to Singapore, and that's sort of the majority of migrant domestic workers globally, is that they're a south to south group. So while migrant domestic workers include irregular workers, I do want to say that the vast majority of them are regularized in this global context, and they are holders of what we could call servant visas. And countries that recognize the need of their citizenry for paid domestic labor and accordingly grant the allocation of this visa span the globe. And I just gave you some examples here on this slide to just give you a sense of how diverse they are. So they would include a country like Denmark and Canada, and also the United Arab Emirates. But what I want to point out is there's also diversity in numbers. And so the numbers of migrants, domestic workers going to Denmark is like 2,000 per year. The number going to Canada is likewise relatively small. Since the inception of the Live-In Caregivers Program, which was in 1983, there's only been 56,000 Filipinos that have gone to Canada through that program. So you contrast this to the fact that there's about 90,000 migrant domestic workers from the Philippines in the United Arab Emirates alone. And so by calling attention to this shared status of migrant domestic workers as unfree workers, what I don't want to do is disregard the fact that there are severe, like significant differences in their work conditions across countries. And so without question, their labor conditions are not uniform, and that these vast differences exist across destinations. And so we see this, for example, in the number of hours that they work. In Denmark, the law says they should only work 3 to 5 hours a day. They will probably work more than that, but the bar is quite low. In contrast, the bar is really high in the United Arab Emirates, where the standards establishes that domestic workers are entitled to 8 hours of rest per day. So that means that legally, employers can demand a 16-hour workday. And so these varying bases result in pretty stark differences in average conditions. And so another example is the kind of domestic work that they do. And so you see Israel and Taiwan are mostly elderly caregivers. In contrast, in other countries, they do childcare or they do what's called all-around work of caring and cleaning and cooking. And so you really see this severe difference in the wages that go from more than $1,000 US a month to the lowest being an average of $215 US a month for your starting wage if you work in the United Arab Emirates. So, but despite these differences, what I really want to emphasize is that migrant domestic workers do share this legal status as bound workers. And again, as bound workers, they can only work for their sponsor, they have to live with that sponsor, and they are unable to easily change that sponsor. And so you can see here how across the globe, this is the case, that receiving states make it very difficult for migrant domestic workers to change their jobs. And so in Singapore, for example, domestic workers have to secure the permission of their employer before they can get a new contract with another employer. And so while uncommon, you do hear that employers sometimes prevent domestic workers from switching employers. And so I want to give you an example of a woman who I met in Singapore. Her name is Michelle. She's worked for the same employer for more than 5 years in Singapore, but she only earns approximately $450 US per month, which is much less than the average salary of those who have worked more than 5 years for the same employer in Singapore, which is about $550 US per month. And so because of this, she wants to change her job, but her employer refuses to release her, which then tells us that employers do, you know, sometimes take advantage of their position as a despot and prevent domestic workers from participating in the labor market. And so I want to say that it's not only in Singapore that this happens. So this limited labor market flexibility is global. And so in Gulf Cooperative Council countries, that would include Kuwait, Oman, Saudi Arabia, United Arab Emirates, in these countries, domestic workers also have to secure the permission of the employer before they can get a new job. In Hong Kong, you don't need the employer's permission, but you do need to find a new job within 2 weeks or else you would get deported back to your country of origin. In Denmark, you can only change twice in the course of 2 years. In Israel, you can only change three times in 63 months, and after that, you're stuck with that same employer. In Taiwan, you can never change employers, and you can only change employers if your employer is found unfit to employ you, and that would happen if your employer died, moved out of the country, or declared bankruptcy. And then Canada is often idealized as that, you know, the mecca of domestic workers because they get, it's the only country where you can come in with a servant visa at the moment and get permanent residency, but that reward is contingent on you working for one employer for two continuous years within a span of 4 years. And so migrant domestic workers, when they come to Canada, they're in this trial period of 4 years and they can only change their employer twice during that time period. And so all these examples, they don't only indicate the fact that domestic workers have limited freedom, you know, to change employers, but you know, we have to remember or just emphasize that it constructs employers as a despot who have complete control over the well-being of their domestic workers. And so I want to say that this power of this constitution of an employer as a despot is not specific to like these countries that we often tag as more brutal, like Asia and the Middle East, but we can see it also occurs in the context of Western countries. So then the legal incorporation of migrant domestic workers as bound laborers basically renders them a mere household dependent in most destinations across the globe. So their legal status as dependents basically agree with a view of domestic workers as one of the family, described by feminist sociologists, including Mary Romero and Judith Rollins, as a controlling mechanism used by employers to solicit uncompensated labor from domestic workers. So not surprisingly then, most countries do not offer labor protection to domestic workers. And if they do, as Abigail Bakken and Diva Stasiulis from Canada have established, enforcement is really difficult because work occurs in the private space of a home. But regardless, the fact is most countries refuse to grant labor protection to domestic workers. So to give you some examples, in Singapore, domestic workers are exempt from the Employment Act. In Taiwan, domestic workers are not covered by the Labor Standards Law, and the newly enacted Domestic Workers Protection Act does not offer labor standards for domestic workers, but it actually entitles them to a contract. And so another example, in Israel, domestic workers historically had the right to a weekly day off, but a 2009 Supreme Court ruling excluded them from the work and rest hour law. As such, they do not have the right to overtime pay or a day off, actually. So a few countries commendably grant labor protection to domestic workers, and you see they're so diverse again. They include Jordan and Canada and Italy, to name a few. And so this absence of labor protection for domestic workers indicates that indeed, as Saskia Sassen would phrase it, domestic workers are what we could say authorized but unrecognized. And so the absence of labor protection results in this inconsistency of a day off for domestic workers. So most host societies mandate a weekly day off for domestic workers, but some do not. So on January 1, 2013, Singapore finally mandated a weekly day off, but what we found was that most employers bypass this by paying their domestic workers 20 Singaporean dollars so as not to take a day off. Member states of Gulf Cooperative Council countries do not have to give a day off. They can, they're just required to give a rest day. So domestics do not have to leave the house, but they are entitled to just rest in the house. And in Taiwan, which has not established any labor standards, likewise, they do not require a day off. And I want to say, finally, neither does Israel, indicating that not all Western countries see the day off as a universal right. And so suggesting the ILO Domestic Worker Convention's relative degree of influence, policies in countries across the globe show a shift towards the greater recognition of the labor rights of domestic workers. And so we see this in the allocation of the right to a contract in Taiwan, and as I mentioned, the implementation of a mandatory day off in Singapore. And we see this also in the UAE, where the domestic workers are no longer controlled by the Ministry of Interior, which is like the Ministry of Immigration, but now by the Ministry of Labor. But regardless of these slight positive changes, domestic workers, we should note, remain a household dependent who are not just legally bound to solely work for their employer, but they're made vulnerable by their extreme relation of unequal dependency. So then how do we make sense of this legal construction of domestic workers as household dependents? And why are nation states who receive domestic workers struggle to recognize them as independent workers? And so across the globe then, nation states are acknowledging their dependence on paid domestic work by facilitating the migration of domestic workers and granting them an employment visa, thus regularizing them. But then at the same time, they just don't give them any flexibility to participate in the labor market, but they bind them to their sponsor. And so what explains this partial recognition, or using Saskia Sassen words again, the author, you know, domestic workers constructed as authorized but unrecognized? And so we cannot deny that the exclusionary condition of domestic workers is probably linked to xenophobia. So the ineligibility of domestic workers for permanent residency and the denial of their right to family reunification speak not only of the lack of recognition of their human rights, but also of their partial citizenship. So while countries recognize the labor of domestic work and accordingly grant legal status to migrants who perform such labor, the terms of their inclusion hinge on their continued exclusion due to their ineligibility for permanent residency. And so migrant domestic workers are undesirable citizens, with the exception of countries like Italy would say, they are permanently temporary. And so what's really interesting, so as I said, I noted earlier that Canada gave domestic workers the pathway to permanent residency, but they actually rescinded that right last year. So I think Italy is alone in giving amnesties to domestic workers. And so some countries even imposed this residency cap on migrant domestic workers. So in Israel, you can only really work there for 63 months, and then afterwards you have to leave. So if you've been working for the same employer, but then they passed away after the 63 months, you have to go. In Taiwan, you're capped at 12 years. You do see, it's interesting in Taiwan, you see this confusion. First, it was capped at 3 years. I think there was so much dependency of employers on these workers, they increased them to 6 years, and then still 6 years was enough, not enough, so now they increased it to 12 years. And the au pairs, we know, are also capped, like 1 year in some countries, 2 years in other countries. In other countries, domestic workers renew their residence visas, but they don't have the option of permanent residency, and this is the case in Singapore, Hong Kong, and destinations in the Middle East. Yet permission to reside continuously does not mean inclusion, and so most of these destinations where domestic workers don't have a cap of residency, they limit the reproductive rights of domestic workers. And so Italy is the only country that grants migrant domestic workers the right to family reunification. And so in Canada, historically, they did not until they got landed status, and now they don't even have that right to landed status. In the US, migrant domestic workers with a non-migrant visa, and those are the holders of B1, A3, or G5 visas, they never qualify for family reunification. And so we would say the worst country for this is probably Singapore, because in Singapore, migrant domestic workers are not, they're not just ineligible to bring their children over to Singapore, but they also can never reproduce with a Singaporean national. And so they are ineligible for marrying Singaporeans even after the end of their contract. So let's say I go back to the Philippines, I was a domestic worker in Singapore, and the Singaporean follows me to the Philippines and we get married, I cannot go back to Singapore to be with him because I was once a domestic worker there. And so if I'm impregnated by this domestic worker, by this Singaporean, my child and myself have no rights of residency in that country. So in other countries, migrant domestic workers can reproduce and stay forever in the country of residence, but if the national does not acknowledge the child, they will get deported. And so a case like that happened in Taiwan. And so the partial citizenship of domestic workers indicates that exclusion and not inclusion defines the politics of integration for migrant domestic workers. And as argued by sociologists Stephen Castles and Alistair Davidson, destination countries impose this process of differential exclusion on migrants and accept them only within strict functional and temporal limits. So they welcome unskilled migrants, including domestic workers as laborers, but not as persons and as temporary sojourners and not long-term residents. And so without question, destination countries do not accord migrant domestic workers the same rights as their own citizens, which basically points to the minimal value of their labor. But it's not just racial exclusion or xenophobia that drives this policy of excluding domestic workers or just of countries not being able to fully recognize domestic workers as independent workers and only constructing them as household dependents. We could say that gender also shapes the politics of their inclusion, and so the refusal of nation states to recognize domestic workers as independent labor migrants basically alludes to the societal dilemma over viewing domestic work as a job. So it's increasingly outsourced to the public as paid labor, but then it's still somehow recognized as something that should be unpaid and private. And so the struggle to recognize migrant domestic workers as independent workers points to this tension then in what Hila Shamir would say is the tensions in the defamiliarization of care. The commodification of care then is haunted by this gendered preference for care to remain a private responsibility that women in the family provide with minimal market and state intervention. So the question then is, what are the effects of this commodification anxiety over domestic workers over domestic work on the workers? And so to address this question, I'm just gonna draw briefly on the literature. We talked about this in the seminar yesterday. And I'm also going to draw from my interviews with domestic workers. And so there's this vast literature on migrant domestic work, but few have actually foregrounded the unfree status of these workers and examined the effects of the status on the actual labor conditions of domestic workers. And this is perhaps because most studies just focus on the everyday experiences of domestic workers and have accordingly documented dynamics of employer-employee relations and the daily work routine of the workers. Or if they don't do that, they sort of just look at the politics of care at large. And there's actually only a few scholars who have addressed the question of how the legal conditions of membership for domestic workers would potentially shape their labor. And so they would include Anna Triantafylidou, who has led the discussion of migrant domestic workers with irregular status here in Europe, Fiona Williams, who theorizes the linkages between markets and states in her formulation of what she calls the transnational political economy of care, and Pei Chia Lan, writing on domestic workers in Taiwan, who compares the experiences of legal servitude for bound laborers and their irregular counterparts, who she argues have greater freedom as free illegals. And so the question remains, how does the status of domestic workers as bound laborers, that is, as indentured workers, shape their work conditions? Or we could ask, how does the relationship of an equal dependency between employers and employees shape labor conditions in domestic work? And so one of the first to address this question had been Bridget Anderson, who examined the effects of indenture on employer-employee relations in Great Britain. She concluded that it promotes nothing but a master-slave relationship. And this literature, the literature that followed did not disagree with Anderson, and all agree that indenture is nothing but a tool of oppression that employers would use to maximize the labor that they can extract from domestic workers. And I think the most famous or well-known discourse that goes around is their constitution as modern-day slaves, which is a framework shared by Kevin Bales. And so Kevin Bales has a very broad definition of slavery. He defines it as, quote, the total control of one person by another for the purpose of economic exploitation. And so clearly, he moves away from the slavery convention of 1926, which basically sees slavery as the status or condition of a person over whom any of all of the powers attaching to the right of ownership are also exercised. So it's not so much control, but ownership that traditionally defined slavery, but for Kevin Bales, it's control. And so for him, as we know, because of this bound labor status, these despots being in control of domestic workers makes them enslaved workers. And so also agreeing with Bales is this notion of domestic workers as trafficking victims. And this viewpoint is advocated by Human Rights Watch. And I'm just going to read you a snippet from the report because it basically shows you how they view unfree labor. And so they said the sponsorship system chains domestic workers to their employers and then leaves them isolated and at risk of abuse behind the closed doors of private homes. With no labor protections for domestic workers, employers can, and many do, overwork, underpay, and abuse these women, unquote. So echoing such negative accounts are the analysis of the kafala or sponsorship system in the Middle East by Madavi and Pandey. Both analytically reduce the unfreedom of bound labor to a form of what they say is structural violence, which is a term coined by Johann Goltag in 1969 and popularized more recently by Paul Farmer to call attention to how social structures or institutions may harm or cause injury to individuals and prevent them from meeting their basic needs. So as I said yesterday, I have a problem with sort of reducing our knowledge or understanding of unfree labor to these structures because, as I noted, it follows this functionalist logic of analysis. And then second, it sort of suggests this uniform effect to structures. And then finally, it basically assumes that all employers, as despotic employers, would be tyrannical despots. So the fact that maybe some employers would not be so tyrannical is something that is not in sort of the imagination of these other scholars. So empirically then, I wanna get into this question of how does unfree labor look on the ground? So to look at unfree labor on the ground, I'm gonna take us to a worse destination. I say it's a worse destination because they're the least paid domestic workers globally. They don't have a pathway to citizenship. They don't have any labor protection. They are sponsored migrants. They don't have the access to a free labor market. And so these are domestic workers in Dubai. People would say that they're actually worse off than their counterparts in Saudi Arabia because the government in Saudi Arabia recently agreed to a $400 minimum wage for their domestic workers. In contrast, the UAE wants to keep wages determined by the market and not so much regulated. And so what actually makes matters worse in a country like UAE and like Saudi Arabia is in those countries, absconding, running away is illegal. And so I've spent some time in the UAE in the last 3 years, and I've done a tremendous amount of interviews, 165, with domestic workers in that country from Indonesia and the Philippines. And what I want to say is that contrary to the picture painted by Human Rights Watch, my data indicates that migrant domestic workers in Dubai are not all abused, but instead they experience a diversity of work conditions. And so some have a day off, others do not. Some are given a monthly vacation every year. Some are given one every 2 years. Some are allowed to do part-time jobs in other households as a means of earning extra income, but most are not. Most are paid by their employers every month, but some are subjected to withheld wages, infantilized by their employers who refuse to pay them until the end of their contract. And that sounds so awful, it is awful, but it's so interesting. In our interview with employers, they admitted to us that they do this with no shame, no guilt. Like, I would be embarrassed, right, to admit to someone, I don't pay my domestic worker until after she works 24 months for me. And their logic is, we pay them, and then 5 months later, they borrow money. And they never have any savings because their family in the Philippines is squandering their money. So what we do is we just keep their salary so that by the time their contract is done, they have this big pool of money that they can invest and start a business with. I mean, that is like just extreme infantilization, right? But most have private bedrooms, but others do not. Some are allowed to have a boyfriend, which is kind of illegal, but most are not allowed to have a boyfriend. Some have access to a mobile phone and internet services, and others do not. Some are overworked. Some interviewees we have worked 18 hours a day. Some work 20 hours a day, while others work for less than 8 hours a day. And a few face extreme brutality at work, with some of our interviewees actually having been raped. Some of our interviewees were tortured, and some, as I talked about yesterday, were starved, and they were only fed once a day. But the vast majority of the people we met in Dubai had not been brutalized, but instead were granted recognition for their personhood. And so even those who run away from their employers, risking imprisonment in the process, you know, we found we're not likely to have been brutalized, as the majority who fled are actually fleeing because they were overworked or because they were denied a day off. And so the reduction of these various experiences to trafficking or slavery flattens this diversity. And so then this leads me to kind of the core and final question I want to ask here, which is that how do we examine unfree labor? How do we account for the severe structural constraints that limit the freedom of domestic workers and their options, but without disregarding their aspirations and actions? And so reading the unfree status of domestic workers as nothing but structural violence or slavery fails to see it as a negotiated process, an enacted reality, which following Michel Foucault is put into effect by actors, who in this case would be employers and domestic workers. And so we first see unfreedom as a negotiated process in the emergence of a diversity of labor conditions. And so this diversity establishes that the structural condition of unfree labor does not have a uniform effect. Variances emerge because, besides structures, including the law that limits the rights of domestic workers, besides structures, their labor conditions are also shaped by cultures, values, and ideologies. And so while these factors could result in the subjugation of domestic workers, which would be the case, for instance, if you have this racist employers who devalue the personhood of the domestic worker, they could also temper the abuse of the worker. And so this is the case, for example, in the UAE, where many of our employers attribute their treatment of domestic workers to their Islamic values. And so in the case of Emirati and other Arab employers and the alignment of these values with, they basically said that Islamic values are aligned with the principles of human rights and that they view domestic workers as a family member, which regardless of the fact that this construction is critiqued by feminist sociologists, they say it guarantees the humane treatment of domestic workers. But what I want to say is that if employers say, I recognize the personhood of my domestic worker, Islamic values fit human rights, principles of human rights, it doesn't necessarily mean that the way they treat domestic workers would fit the standards of the ILO. And so I'll give you this quote, one of our self-identified humane Emirati employers, as he told us why he doesn't give a day off to his domestic worker. I alluded to this yesterday. He said, quote, the hard part about housemaids is they are in a house all day. When you don't see the sun, you are missing something inside. So they should have a day off. But if they have a day off, they don't have the money to do the nice things, only to find a boyfriend. They get pregnant, then both the worker and the employer are in trouble. It's better to take the housemaid with you on errands, on vacation, but not a day off. They will be much happier, unquote. And so unfree labor as a negotiated process raises the question of how we can account for the severe structural constraints that limit the freedom and options of domestic workers without disregarding their aspirations and actions. Indeed, the claim of unfree labor as resulting in slavery is also made complicated by the will of domestic workers. So contrary to the claim of Andrew Gardner that migrant workers in the Gulf continue to migrate because they don't know any better that they'll get abused, migrant domestic workers are quite aware of the risks of their migration. And so I'll give you an example. Nensky, she's a 37-year-old domestic worker in Dubai, told us that she's fully aware of the risks of abuse prior to her migration. As she told us, quote, you know the news about the Arab country. You know about the maid. They beat them. They rape them. They hurt them. They rape the maid. So I took note of these suggestions about Gulf country. But I thought, even in my own country, it could happen. Even my own people, it will happen. So where you go, it is on you. It is your decision how to stay safe, unquote. So indeed, for my study, we spent time in the Philippines observing these pre-deployment seminars for domestic workers bound to the Middle East. And during the break, we would chat with them, and we were chatting with this one group, and we asked them, are you excited to go to the Middle East? And they're like, no, we're kind of scared, we're nervous. And then we're like, well, what are you most scared about? They're like, oh, we're afraid of sex harassment. And then I said, so why are you still going? Oh, because we got trained to protect ourselves. And so then they proceeded to demonstrate to us. They started going like this. You have to go like this, and then like this. And these women are like, 90 pounds. And so they told us that they got this self-defense training. I mean, but you can see then how they, despite all these fears they have, they just put it aside and they just throw themselves out there. They hear this, you know, as I, you know, said yesterday, rape, sexual harassment, all the seminars you go to, you hear that repeatedly throughout the 3 days you spend with them. And these are people who are about to go to the Middle East. So then, I mean, but I don't really have time to get into this. So there's this labor out-migration process. They get educated of the risks of migration. But the problem is they only get educated about these risks once it's too late to change their mind. So you only go to the seminar once you sign a contract. So they don't have this, like, pre-departure orientation, which is like, are you really sure you want to do this? So before you sign your contract, let's tell you what could happen to you. I mean, so that's actually the pretty sad reality that we found there. And so for us then, it's like, how do these domestic workers like will themselves to go to these places? And as I said, it's because for many of them, There is no, they really don't foresee any pathway to economic mobility if they stay in the Philippines. For many of them, the risk of going to a worse destination, such as the UAE, is much better than the prospects of staying in their country of origin. And this is the case for the Filipinos and the Indonesians that we met. And so, like, I'll give you another example. We interviewed an Indian domestic worker, just because what's very interesting is that they're actually, I don't really study ethnicity anymore, but I should, but I don't know how to analyze it. But what's so interesting in the UAE is that there is this co-Asian ethnic allegiance. So if you go to a park, you'll see mostly Filipinos, and then suddenly you see snippets of like Indians, Indonesians, and they're not saying anything, and then you realize, oh my God, they're not Filipino, they're something, you know, they're another ethnic group. And then they were explaining to us, oh, they would just be sitting alone, so we incorporate them into our group so they're not lonely. It, you know, this is when they're not working. But what's interesting is that you have the Africans and the Kenyans sitting alone, and they never incorporate them. And so then they tell us, no, we don't like them, we don't trust them. They, like, you know, try to, you know, basically, they tell on them to the employer, so there's not much affinity with them. But it was interesting, we interviewed this one, we were chatting with this one Indian domestic worker, and she told us, oh, I've been to, she says, I'm like, we're like, how is going to the UAE? And then she says, going to the UAE is like this. And then she kept on doing this, and we didn't know what she was talking about. And then we realized that she was saying it's like Russian roulette. It's like every time you go to the Middle East, it's like playing Russian roulette. And so, you know, the chances of you getting really severely abused is only 1 out of 6. And so for her, every time she gets on the plane, she knows she's playing Russian roulette. That was like pretty intense to hear that, right? So we asked her, well, why don't you just stay in India, where there are a lot of domestic worker jobs? Then she says, by going to the Middle East, I control my situation. Like, I control, like, I am the one making this decision. So you can see then for her, it's negotiating her relationship with her family, distancing herself from her kin, really separating herself from the burden of mothering. And, but then it's at this total risk of playing Russian roulette, right? So I'm just gonna end. So migrant domestic workers from poor countries in the global south, talking not just about the Philippines, as I said in my example of the Indian domestic worker, they migrate globally, and they, what we need to recognize is they can do this because receiving countries grant them the legal status to do this. So they are allowed to do this. But yet this recognition of the need for their labor is partial at best, because it does not extend to their status as being an independent worker. Instead, as I said, they're incorporated as household dependents who in varying degrees are tied to their employer sponsor. In other words, they are rendered unfree workers by the conditions of their membership as migrant laborers. And so as I said, you know, this doesn't necessarily mean that they will automatically get abused, but what it tells us is that they are highly susceptible to abuse. And so then the question is, how do you start chipping away from this legal status, and how do you start recognizing their labor and giving them more flexibility in the labor market? It's an ideal goal, but I think it's one that we are probably unlikely to meet. If I think one important factor is that the fact that we still, as a global society, I wouldn't just say in one particular country, have this struggle of fully recognizing domestic work as something that should be paid, that something that should be regulated, that something that should not just be unpaid work that is designated as a private household responsibility traditionally allocated to women. And a second huge factor that I think leads to the status of indentured workers that I think is a little bit more obvious, obviously, is like xenophobic laws that clearly try to limit the integration of these workers. And so then you see this most clearly because if the numbers are low, countries are more apt to integrate them and give them papers. But if the numbers are high, as you see with Middle Eastern destinations, they are definitely not gonna ever give these workers the same rights as their own citizens. So thank you very much.